Welcome to the Learning in 10 review of epidural abscesses. My name is Dr. Amrita M. Tunker, and I will be giving you this talk today. The learning objectives of my talk include defining and identifying the different types of epidural abscesses, including a spinal epidural abscess and an intracranial epidural abscess. As far as the outline of my talk, we will discuss the epidemiology and the definition of what an epidural abscess is. Then we will delve further into the two types of epidural abscesses. First type we will talk about is the spinal epidural abscess, and we will look at the risk factors, clinical history, and exam findings seen with this type of infection. We will then discuss the differential diagnosis, the sources of infection, the treatment and prognosis of spinal epidural abscesses. Then we will briefly talk about intracranial abscesses. We will discuss the clinical history and exam, and then discuss the diagnosis, treatment, and prognosis of this type of infection. So what are epidural abscesses? They are CNS infections. They are pockets of infection that are enclosed between the bony confines of the skull or the spinal column and the dura. These pockets of infection can expand to compress the brain or the spinal cord. And they are generally categorized into two types based on their location within the central nervous system. The intracranial epidural abscess is located intracranially, and the more common of the two types, the spinal epidural abscess, is located within the spinal column. Spinal epidural abscesses are 9 times more common than intracranial abscesses, and we will delve into the reason why. Spinal epidural abscesses are more common than intracranial epidural abscesses, and this is mainly due to anatomy. There's no true epidural space intracranially since the dura is adhered tightly to the skull within the intracranial vault. In the spinal cord, there is a true epidural space, making the chances of infection much greater. As you move from the cervical to the lumbar region, the epidural space increases in size, and therefore this increases the chances of infection. There's more infection-prone fat tissue in the thoracic or lumbar region, which also helps contribute to increased epidural abscesses in the thoracic or lumbar region as opposed to the cervical region. The diagnosis of spinal epidural abscess is made based on clinical history. Patients will have high risk factors such as trauma to the back, penetrating injuries to the spine, invasive procedures or lines, or being in chronic immunocompromised state, such as having diabetes, liver disease, HIV, or a history of drug use. Patients will also sometimes present with symptoms such as back pain, fever, and neurologic deficits. Unfortunately, a complete triad very rarely exists, and you will need a high clinical suspicion in order to make a proper diagnosis. Laboratory studies may be obtained, but are generally not diagnostic. You will see an elevated ESR and CRP as well as a leukocytosis, but again, these are very non-specific lab tests. You once again need a high clinical suspicion in order to make a proper diagnosis. Lumbar punctures are generally not performed because they are not deemed to be useful for the diagnosis of spinal epidural abscesses. You will see a non-specific elevation in protein and pleocytosis, but again, it will not provide you with any more increased information. As far as imaging is concerned, MRI is by far the most reliable, most sensitive modality. However, in patients who cannot get an MRI for whatever reason, a CT scan with contrast can be done in place of that. Here are two images of epidural abscesses. On the left, you see a picture of a CT scan of an epidural abscess, and on the right, you see a localized epidural abscess pushing in on the spinal column. As visualized by an MRI. Here are two more MRI images which show extremely large epidural abscesses pushing in on the spinal column. These large epidural abscesses span multiple vertebral spaces and therefore are considered a pan-spinal infection. The differential diagnosis for epidural abscesses include metastatic tumors causing cord compression, discitis or vertebral osteomyelitis, an epidural hematoma, meningitis, degenerative disease of the spine, and a herpes zoster infection prior to the onset of a rash. Sources of spinal epidural abscesses include hematogen spread from a systemic infection, direct extension from nearby infected tissue, as well as direct inoculation, whether that is from surgery, epidural catheter placement, or any process of requiring access to the epidural space. Complications from spinal epidural abscesses include endocarditis, vertebral osteomyelitis, and a psoas muscle abscess. Management of a spinal epidural abscess is considered a medical and surgical emergency. Surgical decompression is the initial treatment of choice for most patients. However, some patients will have medical comorbidities, irreversible neurologic deficits, and a panspinal infection, which may preclude surgery altogether. Overall, surgery will improve outcomes of patients with moderate to severe neurologic deficits. Medical management is usually performed in conjunction with surgical decompression. There are certain cases where medical monotherapy can be used in patients. These instances include patients where the causative organism is known and there are no neurologic deficits at the onset of treatment. Patients who are only using medical monotherapy will need to be monitored extremely closely for neurologic deterioration. They will have serial MRIs every 2 to 4 weeks until there is resolution of the abscess, and they will need serial lab monitoring with ESR and CRP. In order to identify the causative organism in the spinal epidural abscess, you will need to draw 2 sets of blood cultures, aspirate the contents. A lumbar puncture, as I stated before, is generally not performed because of the low yield from culture. Empiric treatment for a spinal epidural abscesses must include coverage of staphylococci, streptococci, and gram-negative bacilli. The initial treatment regimen must cover MRSA. A proposed initial treatment regimen includes vancomycin plus metronidazole plus third-generation cephalosporin. The duration of treatment is usually 6 to 8 weeks or until there is complete resolution of the abscess on MRI. As long as the patient is improving, serial MRIs can be performed every 4 to 6 weeks as opposed to the initial treatment. However, if the patient should deteriorate neurologically in any way, then they will need a repeat MRI immediately. As far as the prognosis of spinal epidural abscess is concerned, the overall outcome for the patient is dependent on how long their symptoms were occurring prior to them getting medical attention. 5% of patients with spinal epidural abscesses will die of sepsis and other complications. Another 4 to 22% will suffer irreversible paraplegia. Patients with more severe deficits prior to surgery had worse outcomes. And if the symptoms lasted greater than 24 hours, the patients also had a worse prognosis. Now we'll spend a little bit of time talking about intracranial epidural abscesses. These are less common than spinal epidural abscesses. They are less acute in evolution. They are slow-growing, rounded, and well-localized. Consists of a localized lesion with a central collection of pus surrounded by a wall of inflammatory reaction, which eventually may calcify. Here are 2 CT scans of intracranial epidural abscesses. As you can see, they are a well-localized pocket of infection and have a very nice wall surrounding them. The sources of intracranial epidural abscess include the paranasal sinuses or ears that you can be seen following neurosurgery. And intracranial epidural abscesses cause signs of increased intracranial pressure, including papilledema and focal urologic signs, fevers, headache, lethargy, nausea, and vomiting. Purulent drainage may also be present if the intracranial epidural abscess is caused by sinusitis. Management of intracranial epidural abscess is involving drainage procedure and antibiotic therapy. Drainage of the infection via burr holes or craniotomy is required. If the dura is breached, then fascial graft may also be required. Medical management requires treatment with vancomycin plus metronidazole and a third-generation cephalosporin. Please note that this is the same regimen as seen in spinal epidural abscesses. The prognosis of intracranial epidural abscesses is generally good with less than 10% mortality. So in summary, spinal epidural abscesses are infections in the spinal column in the potential epidural spaces. Rapid identification and treatment is key for these infections. Most are treated with the combination of both surgery and antibiotics. The overall prognosis depends on the duration and severity of symptoms prior to the patient seeking medical attention. Intracranial epidural abscesses are by far less common than spinal epidural abscesses, but they too require surgery and antibiotics. Unlike spinal epidural abscesses, their prognosis is generally very good.